born for racing, I guess. That, or born for competition, because I'm together, that was the combination what I've been made for. It has been for sure important at my time, because Formula One was more and more demanding, physical demanding. In the time I came in, the speeds, the effort, no power steering, lots of manual gearbox. So it was a lot of physical strengths needed. In nowadays, the physical part is actually reduced. The speeds, more or less the same. But you are, now you have power steering, you have power brakes, and you have a lot of support that make the focus for the driving a lot easier. So that means the physical preparation at the same level is probably not exactly necessary, but still good to have. And I always was, in my opinion, the one that was 150 to 200% prepared, because you always want to have reserve for the unforeseen circumstance. Now we're becoming nostalgic because it's so long. Obviously, 91, indeed, Bertrand Gachot, the poor guy, had his problems and wasn't able to race. There was a bit of a fight with Eddie Jordan to get everything sorted, because until Thursday night it wasn't sure whether I was driving on the weekend, because there were some contractual arrangements needed to be finalized. But nevertheless, happened. My first test in Silverstone, the first impression, big shock, the first laps, though I got used to it, and in Spa, yeah, and it put the biggest grin on my face driving at this track with this particular car. It was phenomenal in this circuit. It was a privilege, for sure, to compete not only with Ayrton, but Nigel Mansell, Alan Prost, Thierry Boutsen, Riccardo Patrese, Martin Brundle, so many big names. Obviously, it was the called elder generation. I was the next generation coming in, and yeah, it was a big privilege. At the same time, like with Gerhard Berger, I made some interesting experience. What it means when a young boy comes into an established world of elder guys and drivers, that they have marked their territory, and if somebody wants to enter, you go through some rough moments. Flavio, he came in pretty green into Formula One. He didn't know anything about Formula One, and I think it was a circumstance and coincidence situation that him coming in as a commercial person together with Tom Walkinshaw and his group of people from the racing side, and me doing what I did in Spa, and Briatore just entered, so that as a combination, I guess, with Walkinshaw and Briatore, made them aware of me, and they thought about me. Flavio is Flavio. I mean, he has been phenomenal for that particular team in this particular time, because he was able to give everything in the financial terms, in the management term, that the team needed. At the same time, he knew his limits. He knew he's not the aerodynamic guy. He knew he's not the engineer. So he stuck to his field. And then there was the other group of people that made their job. And this was a fantastic combination And in the end of the day, Flavio remained Flavio. He was a pretty tough businessman. But whenever you were, how you say, a value for his business, it was a perfect match. And that was the case for me. We became good friends and we had a good time together. That was a tough year. We made a phenomenal job with that particular car. The team, and I remember the first test in Silverstone in winter, driving the car the first time. The lap times we did straight out of the box were like, wow. And you could feel it. I mean, you could feel this is a mega package we have available. We haven't been the strongest on the horsepower side because at the time there was the Renault Ford competition. We were short on this one, but the package sometimes is more important than one single aspect that maybe you can be not so good in. We blew the guys away in the early stage of the season because we had such a good combination and managed on the strategy side with Ross being a mastermind for this one. So all the combination with the fuel stop strategy, that was the first time we implemented this into Formula One. This was a perfect matching combination for that particular group being together at the time. But then we all know about all the saga. They were trying to find I clearly can say reasons to make the championship a little bit more interesting because we were gone for the championship. This, I call it a bullshit story about us having traction control and trying to find something. It was just a political thing behind the scene, a game for, probably a little fight between Flavio and some bosses in Formula One. That they found a hook and they pulled it and they gave us the ban and nothing we could do. So we had to live with this. But they didn't even stop, and then they gave us another one in Spa when we were the so-called floor story, when the floor was too thin. Indeed, it was too thin. That's true. You can argue we had this spin kind of accident and whether this was the cause of it, but there was a much more important story that nobody knows, and that is the race before, the car that won in Hockenheim, the plank, we call it the wooden plank, starts with 10 millimeter. Our one was after the race 8.1 at one part, and 9 it was supposed to be. The race before, the car that won had a plank that had only 4 millimeter left, and nothing was done. And the race after, we got kicked out, and nothing had changed in the meantime. There were no new rules, there were no new interpretations. It is what it is. We had to live with it. We had to cope with it. We could nothing do other than physically just do our best, and the best finally, with all the last race, the pressure, the circumstance, what was going on, we made it. And that is the only thing that counts. If you look back to Formula One, what it used to be in the past, there were more drivers than there were journalists. And this changed rapidly in the time, in the 90s until the 2000s. I mean, I recall well over 400 journalists on a race weekend. And I don't know how much it is in nowadays, probably not much less, but not much more either. But that's pretty extreme. And if you think that before, more drivers than journalists, so you know the guys, you talk and you have a more friendly relationship, and they were passionists journalists, but then suddenly you get completely different fields of journalists. You get the boulevard, you get the sports journalist, you get whatever, and that changes obviously the communication, that changes the whole atmosphere and the whole working method. But we are professional, so we try to deal with everything and try to do the best what is possible. But in my case, I always kept the focus on what was the most important, that was the racing business. Yeah, for sure, caused some aggravation with some of your colleagues that they didn't always understand, but that's what you have to go through, because you cannot always satisfy 400 people when you're only one. The most important person in this one, and he was already there, was Jean Todt, very clearly. Because he was the driving force of what happened afterwards. I've never seen, and even in nowadays, I've never seen a person dedicated and working so hard. I thought I was working hard, but it was nothing compared to what he was doing. I mean, he was 7 days a week and well more than 14 hours a day in the office and pushing and being the fireman in all sorts of areas. He very quickly understood our weaknesses. He had a partner, obviously, with me. And together we sort of took Ross Brawn at the time, Rory Byrne, we got him involved. And we formed the magic, I call it, triangle that made Ferrari transforming. It needed time because obviously beforehand it was a different infrastructure that needed to develop. But because we had all the ingredients with the people, starting with Jean and myself, the president, Montezemolo, for sure was very important in then supporting our aim in all financial possibilities. I mean, he never held back on anything. He always supported us and gave us what we needed. And with Jean, he had a very clear program. He was very efficient in all his actions. And yeah, so it was a perfect match. He was the Mr. Grey Eminence in the background. I mean, such a character, such a special person. So passionate about Formula One, I mean, like as well Montezemolo, always, you know, living for Formula One, and whatever we needed, we just needed to ask for it, and they were behind us, they were being so enthusiastic, that was very special, but at the same time, they were very sharp, and very concrete and direct, so yeah, it's clear why those kind of people were successful in whatever they did. Most obvious one is the 7 titles, because in the end of the day, this is the aim. You do all this effort, all this work, not only to win a race, but to win the title. And these are, and naturally the one in 2000 was the most important and the most prestigious one for all of us. And there are the famous words from Jean saying on the podium, life from now on is different. I mean, in a way, all of them, because I've always had an open mind, and I win so many titles and races, I never had the feeling I'm the best. I've always had the feeling I need to improve. I need to watch. I need to see who is doing what better. And all my teammates, with their different characters, abilities, qualities, always showed me something. And I was always awake and paying attention to any little detail and look and search for how to improve. You're scared in the moment you're out of control. You're scared when, like in Silverstone, the brakes don't work and you see the wall coming. Yeah, you're scared, but then what can you do? It is what it is. I've had here and there accidents where you get out of control with a car, you fly around and you have an impact and you don't know what is the consequence. But those are very small moments and in general, you are in control and then everything is fine. I think this was a very exceptional happening, and I don't know the details enough why those tyres happen or why those failures happen. For sure, Silverstone is one of the most high-speed track with the biggest demand on the tyres. Can be that they were overloaded, overstressed. Maybe it was a different reason. We will find out. But there's a much more important thing. I mean, whether a tyre explodes, okay, can be dangerous. We all had this before. You don't want to happen. You don't want to have this. What is much more important to me is that first you have a tyre that is capable for the majority of the teams to be okay, and not for a minority, as last year and this year in a way. Second, it should be a tyre that you can extrapolate at least 80-90% of the capacity of the car. But if you take races like Monaco or Barcelona or whatever, teams and drivers sometimes have to drive less than 50% to keep the tyres alive. And this is something I can see very easily when I watch those races. That's something for sure. It's frustrating and no fun for the drivers. The spectators don't really see the details of this one, but it doesn't match. I mean, you have a car can do this, then you should have tyres. They should match the situation and not have too much of a discrepancy. Sure, it's different. I mean, in 91 you're so full of expectation. You look at this world that is completely new and huge. You don't know anybody, and then after all I had done and achieved, and then coming back, meeting a lot of friends and people that you know, that's very different from that part. The driving, very emotional, maybe close to each other, yeah. I had to deal with a lot more difficult moments compared to the past, to my first part of the career, when I finished at least. But in a way, it probably made me stronger and made me not a different person, but I learned about myself. And to master difficult moments is those ones that teach you and prepare you for life, not when things are easy and you win. I knew exactly, obviously deciding for coming back, I knew what happened, and I knew exactly what will happen for deciding to retire the second time. I always had a life next to Formula One, and I can live this a bit more intense. The family is a very important part to me. I have a lot of actions and hobbies that I enjoy, but saying this, I have a lot of professional life too. Mercedes ambassador, my partners such as DVAG, Navy Boot and so on, that we have projects together and we work together. So I have a nice mix of professional and private life. She has the passion for the horses. She had a horse when she was young. Then she started 10 years ago, more or less, search for what kind of horses, what character of horses. She finally decided for quarter horses, and this is the horses that we have here right now. For the character of the horse and for the safety of the family and for their abilities. After she found out about the sport, because initially you go out in the forest and you enjoy the nature, then she started the competition. And only last year, doing the celebrity show that we do now for 3 years, I thought, well, you know, I'm here anyway. Now I'm traveling with her, so I might as well get a horse for myself. That was difficult, because either the horses are too good or they are maybe in recovery, and to find the horse for me amongst so many that we have, I have to fight. But finally I managed, and today I had actually the second competition, and last year was my first one. The reigning sport of the quarter horse industry, it's certainly a small sport. Though it's the biggest in Europe is in Italy, actually. So what is reining? The horses have to do certain maneuvers. They have to do spinnings, they have to do change of leads. So you do a gallop and suddenly you have to go to the right or left side and change your lead. And the most spectacular, and like you see in those statues, with full speed, the horse kind of pulls the handbrake and slides along the ground, and the quicker and longer, the better and more points you get. So it's a kind of mix of action and dressage, and this is what my wife decided for, the family is doing, and I joined. More or less the same story as usual. I mean, yeah, you have a little bit more issues, obviously, on the tyre side. It already started to me last year. I made a comment a little bit ahead of time after Bahrain race last year, what problems we have, and those problems have extrapolated this year even further. But other than this one, in the end, the better one wins, and that's what it's supposed to be. First of all, those names that you mentioned, and you probably miss some other names that they're in the same category, they're just the greatest that we have now in Formula One. They're all humans, for sure they have weaknesses. They all work very hard not to show them, because that's one of the secrets, that you just want to appear to be strong at all times and don't have weaknesses. But no reason to get in them, into them too much, other than to say the better one should win. In this case, I have no regrets to say that I love both. I had a fantastic time, and probably the greatest in terms of sportive success, of friendships in the days of Ferrari. But then I had a good time as well in the Mercedes days, and they're good people. I'm happy to work with them. It's different, but life, why not to be different? Monte Carlo is probably one of the greatest places to race, to have action. I remember, even it being a difficult year, 2006, it was my last year, but coming from the back and going through the field and finishing fifth, that was a pretty special race. I mean, I'm a lucky person. I live my dreams.
Thank you.
Welcome. insomma, grazie anche per voi, siete venuti qui, nostra casa e anche passione.